Hello, everyone. How are you? Come on. How are you?
Yes.
Thank you. It's Saturday night. You said it was a Baz Luhrmann. Come on. It's a party.
How many people got something better to do on a Saturday night?
So before we start, I just want to say this is not a totally objective interview. I've been working with Baz for the last 2 years on the show you saw clips at the end of, which was The Get Down. And I'm sure we'll definitely talk about that. But I thought, as you know, Baz is a master of using music, cinema, image, and melding. And in light of the passing this week of Prince Rogers Nelson, I was looking online today and I realized that one of the major sequences in Romeo and Juliet uses When Doves Cry. So I was thinking we'd kind of start talking about why you chose that song. You talk about what the scene is, why you chose that song, and how was it working with Prince?
Ooh. I think from day one, mainly because of my upbringing in the theater and in a classical storytelling sense, music to me has always been text. We've right. talked about it, right. Nelson. We talked right. about it a right. lot right. when we started doing The Get Down. That is that music can be used in storytelling as background, it can be used to support, but in a music-driven storytelling piece, it's used as text, like it advances the plot. And Romeo and Juliet was a really extraordinary journey alone because I set out to look at, you know, if Shakespeare were making a film, how might he go about doing that? So I spent years doing a kind of, I mean, I was already pretty steeped in the world of Shakespeare and how he went about making plays, but I spent a lot of time researching that. So despite what some, you know, analysts say, oh, you know, the MTV, Romeo and Juliet, all the choices were made based on things that happened in the Elizabethan theater. Now, one of the things they did in Shakespeare's time was he would have taken a popular song of the time and put it right in the middle of the play, like a balladeer where he'd take that song and use it to advance the story. So I was really committed to that, also because the language is musical. Iambic is musical. So, you know, it had to sit in with this musical language. And when Craig Pitts and I started working on the text, we didn't write the adaption and then go, gee, what song will we put in it? We wrote, and a choir boy sings a acapella gospel version of When Doves Cry. So we wrote it into the script. And then came to think of getting it, because at that stage I was like this, you know, I sounded a bit more like I did in that video, you know, hi, I'm Baz Luhrmann, I'm directing Strictly Ballroom, you know. So I kind of reached out to Prince and, hi, I'm Baz Luhrmann, I'd really like to use Doves Cry. And yeah, that in that and at that time, it was just a moment of, yeah, that sounds like a great idea, and I got a lot of good support, and he said yes. However, there is a tag to this story, which is one of the great sadnesses that I've been reminded of with the passing of Prince is that on Gatsby, where I had a considerably deeper relationship, having worked through Moulin Rouge, having worked with so many great artists, both on an intimate level, in the studio, having learnt to produce, because I've made a lot of music, I was working with Prince on a song for Gatsby, and it was a reimagined version of a song he did with Matika called Love Thy Will Be Done, and it was going to be a major piece in it. And we did work on it. I mean, he was in Australia touring. We did some work there. We did further work on it. In fact, we worked on it a lot. And there just came a moment when he couldn't quite, it's a co-owned piece, and he couldn't quite get it released. And at that stage, I had to make another decision. And so I went and I worked with Lana Del Rey to do the piece we did, which ended up being that sequel.
Beautiful song.
But, yeah, you know, working with him, I mean, he is as he appears to be. That's a sound effect. Was that a motorbike? I don't know what it was, but it was definitely present. Anyway, working with him, and, you know, he is what he appears to be, just one of a kind. Like, there's only, you know, there's only Prince, and it's a great sadness that he's
Could you talk a little bit then about that particular arrangement? Because it's very radically different.
Yeah.
And it speaks to, I think, your way of hearing music in general.
Well, I particularly, I mean, the whole thing with Romeo and Juliet was, I mean, being inspired by Shakespeare, that he wasn't thematically consistent. You know, if you look at Romeo and Juliet in an Elizabethan sense, it opens with stand-up comedy. I mean, two comics will come on and go, gee, bite your thumb at me, sir, you know. And then it would go into, you know, high tragedy. There would be music. There would be poetry. You've got to remember, Juliet was played by a boy. So there was a contract with the audience about the gear shifts. It wasn't the sort of drama we're used to, where you're either in a comedy or you're in a tragedy or you're in a thriller. So this gear shifting thing was a conundrum. And what I wanted to do was signal to our audience that you could take something you knew and interpret it in a different way so that it delivered a different emotional content. Like Doves Cry, the original one, you know, can you believe that guitar? Amazing. Imagine it now. Amazing. You know, but it was such a great driving, sexy, you know, it was a dance track. So what if you took that iconic dance track and made it into this kind of pure religious wedding song? So it's looking at something, turning it over, and using it and interpreting it in a different way.
So one of the big revelations, as you referenced it earlier, was text.
Yeah.
As a writer on The Get Down, one of the revelations the writers had was that we never were writing scripts. We're writing text. We're like, okay, what does that mean? In the Boz world, which I've entered for the last 2 years, the script is I think you call it a map.
Look, I have great reverence. I mean, reverence... I mean, first of all, we've got everything on The Get Down, as you well know, Nelson, has been, whatever we thought we were getting into, it was like every corner is a surprise. There is no precedent for what we're trying to make, and in fact, what we're making. One of the great joys, amidst many joys and lots of labor, is the writing team and the vast and the breadth of experience and the kind of writers, like the good self, you know, Stephen Adley Gerges, who is the way to say it is a unique human being.
Yes, and a Pulitzer Prize winner.
Well, Aaron Thomas, Seth Rosenfeld, when I think about the team and more, but the team of writers, there's also the music writers.
Right.
And bringing them together to make, I mean, the text is a map because it's very, very evolved map. But I think the way I like to describe it is that where I tend to want to go, it's like Columbus in America. We kind of know it's out there across the ocean somewhere. We got this map. Someone drew it. Let's get a crew together and some supplies and wish us luck. But, you know, the thing called the stars. I think we're supposed to turn left here, you know. And I only say that because where I tend to want to go, there is no real precedent for it.
And I'll say, when we started working on the show, I got a copy from you guys of the Moulin Rouge script because I didn't understand how do you write that kind of thing? And now I realize that you don't write that kind of thing. It evolves out of a process. And I think one of the words that you use all the time is musicalization.
Sure, yes.
So could you talk to people about what that means?
I sure can, yes. Yeah. Nelson. Right? What musicalization is, and I mean, I don't even know if it's a real word, but but it's certainly real for us. And what it is we set out, we do the underlying carriage of the structure of the story. So it's usually universal. The stories I tend to work on, because we're using music to express an emotion or amplify a feeling, tend to be classical structures. So we've got that. Then we've defined character and so on and so forth. Now, musicalization is you've written a scene. You know this, Nelson, because you went through it. But I sort of assume everyone understands it. It takes a long time to actually wrap your head around.
Right.
And that is that in the most basic sense, if it's a music-driven piece of storytelling, the music has got to advance the plot and the character's emotional state.
Right.
So instead of saying, I love you, I love you, I love you, you sing it.
Right.
Now, if you
or
don't,
rhyme it.
Or rhyme it. Or if you don't break out into song and you're using a track, then the music has to Greek chorus, comment on it,
right.
You know, connect to disparate sequences and have some kind of extra layer of expression that is in concert with what's going on between the actors. So Oh, that doesn't sound too complicated. But the whole idea is you say, well, you've got to dramatize this. And how do you do it musically?
So let's use an example for the audience. I worked at Moulin Rouge today. And there's this fantastic sequence of a tango dance.
Right.
Where you have three things going on. You have actual tango.
That's a weave, yeah.
Which so you have the drama of the tango, which is basically a sort of a menage that turns into almost like an orgy, in a sense, right? Am I right?
There's an orgy in Moulin Rouge?
Close.
So are you sure you saw my film?
I think so.
That John Huston has an orgy in it.
So there's this dance, amazing dance sequence. At the same time, Ewan McGregor is pining for Nicole Kidman, and he's kind of in an interior monologue about his drama.
Mm-hmm.
And he's with the tango, but he's also kind of in his own universe.
Yes.
And then you have a separate drama happening where you have the Duke has Nicole Kidman for dinner.
Yes.
And he's trying to seduce her buyer. So these three things are all weaved around Roxanne by the police. And I think there's also a tango. Or
a very famous, yes, you're quite right, and you remind me, a very famous tango, which we reinterpolate and weave through it. Yes.
So one of the things that it seems like it's a consistent thread, and I know this is something, again, having experienced it on the Get Down, this idea of the weave, it's a huge part of your storytelling style. And I'm just curious about what are the, because it's very unique. No one kind of does this anymore.
Right. You know what? Nelson, I mean, I'm hearing this back from you, and it's somewhat inherent, but it's very technical.
Right.
But someone like Mozart, in writing an opera, because I had a big opera background, would have gone, I mean, if you've ever seen Amadeus, there's that scene, I don't know if you've ever seen that film. It's about Mozart, right? Okay. All right. It's available on DVD in the foyer. Not that anyone sells DVDs anymore. Download it on Netflix. The thing is that in that, it's a great interpretation. I mean, as biography goes, I don't ever really believe. Biography is never really the telling of a character. It's the expression of some sort of universal. It's using someone's life as a canvas to express a larger idea. In the case of Amadeus, it's really about jealousy, Salieri. Having said that, there's that great scene, and I think it's pretty credible, where Mozart's there with the Duke, and he's commissioned to write Marriage of Figaro, and he's going, sire, sire, how many characters do you think are singing at once? And this is something that music can do that drama can't quite do in the same way, and that is that you can have four or five, either two or three characters or two or three storylines where the music is allowing them to cross-fertilize each other. So you understand, for example, the one we were working on last night.
Right.
One character is desperately trying to find this bootlegged tape, and the other character is desperately, he's got writer's block, trying to write a disco song, and he's taking copious amounts of drugs and banging his head against the piano. Now, musically, we bind these two things together. But what are they both sharing? Desperation. Two characters, two storylines, one emotional state. So the banging of the piano is the underlying rhythmic score to the and his kind of repetitive tune to this other musical drama of him searching for the cassette. It's a minor example, but that's kind of something that music can do dramatically that you can't quite do when it's just straight drama.
So one of the other things we've talked about in conversation is the idea of cinema of expression versus cinema of realism.
Sure.
And what you do is, I think you've said to me that you feel like you do a throwback in a sense. You're not doing naturalism. You do something more akin with, I don't know, a 40s director. Am I misstating Baz or am I close?
Thank you. Yeah, 40s director. You mean like Orson Welles?
Exactly. Because actually we used I think Citizen Kane was one of the reference points.
Here's the thing, it's come up. I mean, I'm old now, so I have had to actually accept that when people ask you enough, why is that so, kind of think about it. And by the way, I grew up dramatically because I had theater companies, I did opera companies, I did lots of stuff. I was a pretty energetic young fellow, and I did lots of things, and I did psychological drama, a lot of it, and I was trained in that. And by the way, I love psychological dramas, just for the record. I was only saying the other day, a film like Spotlight is so beautifully observed. It's so beautifully acted. What that is that you as a viewer are somewhat put to sleep. It's keyhole drama. You're looking, you're forgetting yourself, you're observing the drama, and you're meant to forget your presence, but most importantly, the storyteller's presence, the filmmaker's presence. You're meant to just sit in on their lives. That's what I call psychological drama. Now, what's interesting, and I love it, and what's interesting is that it came in a great, I mean, it's existed before, but it came as a reaction, particularly in the 70s, the French New Wave, all of that, against this kind of artificial drama of which Orson Welles or Citizen Kane or, you know, Lawrence of Arabia or musicals, or you, because the way that those films work is completely different. You know, you are aware that you're participating with the storyteller in a journey. And, you know, they're not, you're not meant to be looking through a keyhole at realism. The real interesting thing, which came up the other day with you when you brought it, and I thought that's probably true, is why. And what happened to me was I grew up in a very isolated place, tiny country town. And at one stage we had the cinema, because the fellow that brought gasoline to us, because we had a gas station and a farm and shops and, you know, it was mad. My brother had grew, you know, flowers. Such a lovely guy. And I bred fish and, you know, it was madness. I didn't think it was, but we did a lot of things. But at one stage, the guy that supplied gasoline, he passed away. And my father was in the Vietnam War. He knew how to thread film. He taught me photography. He was obsessed with photography. He met my mother through photography. So anyway, we ran the cinema. And I was like literally sort of cinema paradiso style, watching movies come out of cans and sitting in the bio box and all that. But at the same time, we had this one black and white television and we lived in the middle of nowhere, so it only had one channel. And they gave away what they considered junk movies, like for nothing. Now, in the 70s, junk movies would be something like The Red Shoes or Citizen Kane or you know, The Young Lions. So I was fed at a very early age on these kind of heightened cinema that was being reacted against as I was growing up. You know, like the 70s had come along, the new wave and all of that. So I think it left a kind of sense of, they're romantic in the sense that they're amplifications, they're expressionistic, and I think I got lumbered with that one.
Well, also, I mean, you don't leave out Bars Radio.
Yeah.
Then you have a childhood...
I'm never telling you anything again.
Then you have a childhood radio station?
I trusted you. Well, it was very isolated, and my father encouraged all sorts of different creative folk to come and live with us. Like, there's a painter live with us. I know it sounds bonkers, but it's totally happened, and we were kind of the Renaissance players of Erin's Creek, you know? So we'd be doing ballroom dancing, riding horses, scuba diving, commando training, you know, and learning to paint, you know? But at one stage, yeah, it's about music, I suppose. Yeah, at one stage, Nelson said, when did you ever have your first, buy your first record? And I said, well, someone threw away a record player. Mm. And I got the record player and rigged it up to speakers at the gas station. And there were these three records, the two I can't remember, but one was called One is the Loneliest Number by John Farnham.
Right.
And I just played it over and over again. I had a microphone going, and welcome to Radio MOBIL. Let's hit that hot wax. You know? and then this song would go round and round and round and round. And then I eventually got my little brother to break up the program to come in and read the paper about sports, because he was a sports reporter. But yes, I had my own radio station.
Well, and you know why this is very interesting is because one of the shocking things of watching you direct, particularly the music sequences, which are elaborate and amazing on our show, is that Boz, he DJs the shoot. Okay, so we're there, there's dancers, and he's on the mic, yo, 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 let's go, rock, rock. He's giving high energy MC all night. I mean, I'm talking about for hours, because we have dancers.
You do that much better than me, Nelson.
But you're going for it, man. Yeah. And also, so I'm literally, he's like he's a DJ or an MC at a party of his own shoot. And so when you look at the big dance numbers, which you're not gonna, which you're gonna miss out on, unfortunately, is Boz's commentary during the shoot of that girl in the red dress. Let's go.
I never said anything to a CM. It was professional. Actually, it's for a very good purpose, because one of the things about shooting large party sequences or sequences with lots of what people refer to as background, I have a rule. There is no background in my films, and there are no extras and actors. Everybody's acting. So the first thing I do is I do that, and I put myself on the line, because what I really want is everybody to, not to be scared of the stars. One of the things that happens on a set is that if Jimmy Schmitz is there or it's Leonardo, all of the people in the crowd scene sort of walk like, it's him, you know? And I want them to go up and touch him and grab him and really be visceral in the scene. So I do that, and I think it's my job to lead with energy. And if I can kind of be foolish and fearless, then, you know, the actor in this tiniest role down at the back holding the, you know, tinsel, they can be fearless and foolish. So I really want the audience to believe that that party scene is very real. Now, actually, on the Gatsby ones, which were so elaborate, I did it very traditionally like that. But I have to say that when we got done, Leonardo would come down and he would sit there, and I got all the cameras cranked up, and then I just put on these giant, you know, rolls, and we cranked up the music, and we let people have a little. Went on for a long time and got very out of hand, you know? but I only do that at the end, after everyone's learned how to be wild and crazy, you know?
But there's one moment, amazing moment. There's a sequence you saw in that little trailer of a gentleman in a white suit dancing in the Get Down scene. His character's name is Cadillac in the show. And so one of these nights, they've been dancing for hours and hours. Something happened that was like one of those things that doesn't... You don't think about it as a movie scene. You think about it as something that happens in theater, I guess, or in a concert performance, where the actor, Boz is, you know, gassing him up all night. The audience is thought he's getting more. He just kind of went off book or something, and magic happened, and he actually became John Travolta.
Yeah.
He literally did. It was like, and everyone in the room, even the board cameramen, everyone's like, what the fuck just happened? And it was a magical thing, and it partly because the environment that is created was not of a sterile, we're gonna shoot this thing and get it. It was a party.
Well, Nelson, good point, because Shakespeare would say, we are players. You know, it's called a screenplay.
Right.
It's not called a screen work, it's called a screenplay. Right. You know, you are play acting. So there's a lot of work that has to happen.
Right.
But if you get the environment right, at some point, the play within all of us, particularly within actors, can take over. And there's this magical thing, you can get it so far, but there's this absolutely magical thing, which is kind of like surfing on top of it, where neither the actor nor the director nor anyone in the room is actually in control of it. It's some sort of moment, and if it happens, and it doesn't always happen, but if it happens, you know it's happening. And it's this play, and it kind of sits somewhere between the technique and the story you're telling and everything there, and it just happens, and we all know it. We were like, John Travolta.
It was amazing. So, I think one of the things that people don't appreciate about your work is the amount of detail and research that goes into it. And particularly, let's talk about Gatsby, because Gatsby was a film that many had a bone of contention with because it wasn't faithful to Fitzgerald or whatever.
I didn't notice that.
Oh, some people.
Really?
A couple. But in fact, I would love for you to talk about the bookend sequence, because I think that with Tobey Maguire and where that came from, because I think that speaks to the kind of research that goes into your productions.
Look, I have absolutely no problem. It's very simple. We've talked about this before. Right. With the work that I do, because it is expressionistic, we have a thing in the form where it's called the sign-on moment, and you either sign on to it and surrender to it and go, I'm going to participate in this, or you just may as well leave, you know. Trust me, people have, right? But if you sign on, it's an old form, then you and it have this relationship where you participate in the work. Now, having said that, they're just choices. One of the great privileges of, and it's a really great privilege, of being in the place that I am, is that A, I can decide what to make, but most importantly, I get funded to go and spend a lot of time steeping myself in the world, working as I did with Gatsby with the greatest academics on the text in the world. you know, being down at Princeton, seeing the original text.
That's where his papers are collected.
Yeah,
right?
His full collection down there. Working alongside, you know, people who knew him, and out of that, building with my collaborative team, with Craig, who was co-writing with me, has co-written many things with me, with Catherine Martin, CM, my wife. She's the one with the Oscars.
We'll She's got four, baby, four.
Yeah.
You need one for the thumb.
Come on, hold them up. She takes...
Bring them with me today.
Oh, that's right, it's date night. She only leaves them home on date night. What I wanted to say is that I really do take... I mean, it's so great. Like, I never want to make the films. I just, you know, I live it. I mean, we even went as far as Fitzgerald talks about... when he goes from London about coming into New York, and that passage is written where he is going under the Statue of Liberty on an ocean liner. And so, of course, I had to get an ocean liner from London to New York to start the process. But here's what happened. One of the things, for example, in the book is people sometimes, some academics, not all of them, refer to the book as a very quiet, restrained book. Well, yes, because it's an internal narration, but it's an internal narration about an extremely boisterous, colorful, in-your-face, you know, garish, energetic world about a guy who is essentially a gangster and you know, some pretty, contextually, some very unsavory things. So one of the things that I wanted to do was find a way of also maintaining as much of that internal narrative as possible, because after a while, dense narration, you sort of button out from it. When I was going through the research, in Fitzgerald's last, you know, Craig and I variously talked about, well, you know, could he be speaking to you know, because in the book he says Gatsby, who is the subject of this book. So, you know, Nick Carraway is writing a book. In fact, Nick Carraway goes on to write the book to clearly deal with his feelings about Gatsby, and probably because he's starting out on Wall Street, essentially being a trader, probably decides he's going to pursue his creative journey. Mm. So we wanted a way to express that and externalize that. So as I was going through all the other texts, I found that we talked for a while about, oh, wouldn't it be interesting if he was dealing with his alcoholism, because Fitzgerald had the same problem,
sure.
The crack up, all of that. We found that Fitzgerald had actually put one of his major characters from his last book in an asylum with a doctor, and this was a narrative device, which he didn't use. Mm. And I went, well, that would be a great mechanism.
From his unfinished novel, right? From his unfinished
I think it's Last Tycoon.
Right, right.
So we thought, well, that would be a great device. And so at some stage, I got a brilliant, it was the preeminent psychoanalyst from Kansas City whose family brought psychoanalysis to the United States, to come down, and Walter, and he was so brilliant a man, and in fact, the character in our film is based on him. Mm. And he came down, and I got him to sit with Toby McGuire and psychoanalyze him. And Walter was fantastic, because I feel there are things that you're holding back. There's more, Toby, that you want to unburden yourself with. So Toby would be, and I was kind of thinking, I've never been into psychoanalysis, and I was really getting so much from it myself. You know, I was going like, this feels really good. So we videoed it, and Toby found it really kind of like both destabilizing and enriching.
Right.
And we use that as a template for the book. So I don't know, I mean, these, you know, windbaggy, long-ended stories, but that is how we go about our process. It isn't, and I don't want to sound defensive about it because, you know, the works are what they are, but it isn't haphazard. No decision in the film is random. You know?
All right, so I want to do a segue here, but because one of the things about the Get Down experience, it's 1970s New York, it's the Bronx, it's Studio 54-esque, it's downtown, and one of the things that's interesting is that I took Baz to the South Bronx.
First time, Matt. Oh, well, I'd been there before, but what, that was so great.
Keep
talking about that was an amazing night, actually.
Just walked around looking, you know, just where, what does it look like, where we're going, and then you got... Catherine Martin, who's a genius, and your wife, is
has four Oscars.
These incredible, the detail work. If you walked into the offices of the Get Down, especially when the walls were just covered with photos of gangbangers, gay liberation movement, Black Panthers, B-Boys, you're just immersed visually in the era. And then there was the map work that was done for the, so literally there was a mapping done of the South Bronx, which detailed every club in 1977, 78, 79 that existed, as well as high schools, any place that our characters would have interacted. So the work that goes into your films is pretty is incredibly detailed. And I think that it's a tribute. I think knowing you now and having seen the other films, the way you did Paris as Moulin Rouge, going back to what you did with Romeo and Juliet, it's an incredible amount of work that goes in between your projects to make these things happen.
Sure.
And I say that because I'm supposed to segue to a clip of The Get Down.
But before you do, Nels,
yes.
I just want to say, like, really, yes. And then when we started our relationship, our journey, and you, and I was already physically going there, but then you took me on a really personal ride with it. But then this whole other thing, like, I mean, no, any wonder, you know, this privileged part of it, like how many hours and days and weeks have we spent? I mean, you are the preeminent historian of this subject, and yet even you, together, we've been peeling off layers of discovery, of information. I mean, every day that is what sustains you. The work, the labor is immense, but that just keeps you going. And it's, imagine we've been paid to do that.
It's a good thing. All right, let's show a clip. This is, some of the footage will be familiar from the early clip, and we'll have other stuff too. So this is The Get Down coming out on Netflix in August. At the end, you hear that mix of spoken word, hip-hop, and singing. That's the kind of weaving that we're talking about. He's done it in previous projects, obviously, but it's a huge feature of our show.
You know, Nelson, it's probably worth saying, and Nelson has been such a great help here in it, but the period that we picked, you know, I was drawn to the subject 10 years ago, many years ago, because growing up in Australia, fascinated by New York, its transformation. But I was always compelled towards this question, which is, in this borough that was on its knees, how did so much creativity come out of it? And how did it come out of it and go on to change not just the city, but the entire globe? Like, that's the question that drew me in, not let's do the history of hip-hop. People say that, and it's not really true. If anything, it's the prehistory.
Yeah.
Because what's really interesting is that the years we've set it in, 1977 was the biggest year in musical history. Nelson taught me that. And disco was reigning. Like, disco was unassailable. And we have a character, that young girl is going, I'm going to be a disco star.
Right.
There was no other road. It was like disco was king. Her very smart young boyfriend, he's going, oh, yeah, but I've got this thing. He met this guy called Shaolin Fantastic, who takes him to this party where they're doing this thing with records, and there's a guy there called Grandmaster Flash, right? Now, Grandmaster Flash, by the way, who is among with many of the incredible collaborators we're working with, I mean, he's a producer on the show.
Yes.
I just spoke to him here. He's in it as a young character. So is Kool Herc. Like, the founding fathers are in the show, but our mythical characters engage with them. I mean, they have something to do with them. What's so fascinating is that while she's going downtown, I'm going to be a disco star, Donna Summer, Studio 54, they're doing this thing with the records, and she's going like, I'm going to be, this thing with the records, that's never going to amount to anything.
Which was the conventional wisdom of anybody who heard it at the time.
And I mean, she's on the cultural Titanic, you know, three years later in 78, you know? I don't know, did you see the White Sox game up at Chicago where they burn disco records? And they destroy the game. And what's amazing about that, and this we're dealing with, is that in 79, only 2 years later, disco crashes overnight. In that same summer, no one's ever heard of this rhyming business over beats. In that same summer, Sugar Hill Gang drops, which is really a kind of created band out of Jersey. Correct me if I'm wrong, Nelson.
No, you're right.
Right? Everyone goes like, what is this talky-talky stuff? Isn't it great? 3 months later, there is nothing less than, I think, 5 hip-hop records in the last month
in
of
December,
the decade
79.
In the charts. And, of course, fade in, you know, I'm not going to talk about season two, but the 80s, you know, right? Because the transition is so quick.
Yeah.
And it's just contained to this little geographical area. So that's what really attracted me. It was, yes, the prehistory of hip-hop, but also the way disco and hip-hop and punk.
Yeah.
They all lived side by side. They were all just had this sort of parallel universe, and that was kind of the motivation for it. It's brought us to work with really extraordinary collaborators on every level, not to mention the cast. We're very gifted there, too.
Well, I mean, there's a very significant figure in hip-hop who's helping us. You should talk about him.
Yes. I mean, as I said, Flash. We have a lot of the founding fathers working.
Raheem from the Furious Five.
Raheem has been writing rhymes with us. Curtis Blow, to all our young performers, I mean, all the Smiths, I shouldn't say that, but we have Justice and Jaden Smith and Jimmy Schmitz. You know, there's a lot of JS in our show. But and they're wonderful. And Shamik Moore,
who was in Dope.
Yeah. You know, Young Horizon, they're all young and at the beginning of their careers. There's a young fella who's 14. We discovered him rhyming in the subway in the Bronx. And now he's in 13 episodes of The Get Down as the lead player. So we have our cast. But then we have all these collaborations musically, and I'm not going to go into the list because it's vast and many of them you would know and very significant writers, but one of the great collaborations is Raheem. I mean, Curtis Blow, for example, had to teach all the young cars when they're rapping how to do old school rapping. You know, like all our guys kind of do this, but the way you stood.
He literally spent time with how to hold the mic.
The politics of it, what that meant. Yeah. You know, they had to be reprogrammed because their experience of rap was 90s rap. Now, one of the things, which I don't think anyone knows because it's not in the trailers, and we've been doing this for about a year now, is that one of the characters, I won't spoiler alert it to you, goes on and we discover that he's actually a successful rap star in the 90s. And he narrates it through rhyme, through rap. And this character, as it turns out, is played on stage and kind of at sort of Madison Square Garden. And what we've been, one of the great collaborations is that I've been working really closely in creating these rhymes. And one of the great, and he's a producer on the film with one of the most iconic voices of the 90s, and that's Nas. And so Nas has been this other huge creative force in the production. And so, and it's been playing really, really successfully in that it's probably, I was only saying to Nas before I came on the phone, it's somewhere between pure rap, narration, and sort of Greek chorus comment. And we use it a lot throughout it, you know? So that's become something really, we weren't sure about it when we began. It's become tremendously, we couldn't do without it now.
Absolutely.
You know, and he's been fantastic in that regard. And David, actually half of the cast of Hamilton are in the show. So David, So David, who plays that character on stage, is in it.
I think he plays Lafayette in the play.
Yeah. Jefferson.
Jefferson, okay, thank you.
Yeah. he could play either role. He's that good.
So I think it's time for questions from the audience. As I understand it, there will be some gentlemen or gentlemen. There's a gentleman with a mic. There's another one in the back. So let's start right there.
I'm freaking out right now. Okay, so I was wondering, I can't even just describe how much respect I have for you and Catherine. Would you ever consider doing an adaptation of Wicked, Gregory
McQuarrie's work. Yeah. What's your name?
Jessica.
Jessica.
I never thought this would happen. This
you know what?
Jessica, you have the hat on like you're ready for the production.
Honestly, I kind of wore it to be creepy like that. I was like, I could be Elsa. Anyway, go.
Come up here and we'll do gravity for everyone.
No,
all right?
No.
No, okay.
But I will clean toilets, to be honest, with you. But anyway.
You know what? One of the lucky things we have, Sam and I, and my whole creative team, is that we have and I've always been like this, I've always seen creativity as an adventure, which is why we found ourselves doing, I don't really think of myself as particularly a filmmaker or a music maker or a maker of plays, or, you know, we've done hotels, you know, things like that, because it was an adventure, you know. Having said that, the short answer is, Wicked has come my way many times, as have some of the other great musicals. And I always look at them and go, well, that would be fun. Wouldn't that be great? And then I think to myself, no, probably someone else could do that. And I always feel my job is to do something that no one else will. And sort of, you know, like when I did Moulin Rouge, honestly, you have no idea how many very well-known, very trusted people said to me, you're insane. The musical will never work again. The musical can never be popular again in cinema. You know, and that's okay. I really respect that. But I went like, I kind of think it can, and I got to get that done. So the likelihood of me doing Wicked is probably not going to happen. But it's a great show, and someone will do a good job of it in the cinema, I'm sure.
So on this side, anybody? Right there, could you get the English? Thank you.
Hi, I just have a comment. I was actually sitting here with my cousin trying to think of any other work similar to your question as to how did a city that was on its knees come about and change the history of the world, music history of the world. And we couldn't think of any.
Yes.
I know you said that a lot of the work you've done, no one else has been there, still in uncharted territory. Yeah. You know about the direction you want to go. And I literally could not think of any other project or work that has actually gone into the history of prehistoric work of hip hop, that story.
What's your name?
My name is Daphne.
Daphne, do you know what? You have brought up something that has come up. Nelson comes up on a regular basis, and it comes up with people like Flash. It comes up with people like, you know, by the way, we do graffiti as well. So Crash and Days and legends like that are in our show and have collaborated with us on getting that, telling that story. We tell it from the young people's point of view. So we see it, of course, they're difficult, dangerous streets, but we're not looking outside in. We're telling it from the kids' point of view. So they... all the people who've written with us and collaborated to tell the story, they singularly say what they saw was possibility, you know? But your point, Daphne, is I do not actually have an answer. And what happens is everyone we work with goes, yeah, why? Like, why? Like, why hasn't someone thought? And I slightly think there's two things. Flash says, he's got a great metaphor. He says, everyone wants to know about the cake.
Right, the cake.
But no one wants to know about the recipe, meaning everyone's interested in the 80s because it was like happening. But no one's kind of interested, how did it actually come about, you know? There's that. And I think the other thing is, and I don't want to tread into difficult territory, but I think that, I mean, one of the wonderful things, I don't do a spoiler alert, but working with Herc, and Herc at some stage said, I've got to tell you the secret, you know? And I thought, oh, well, this is going to be like, you know, what's the secret, you know? And he and Cindy, his wonderful sister, we were up at Freeman House, which has been, Freeman House is like our clubhouse. It's this wonderful old mansion off the Grand Concourse, and it's run by great people. And Herc lives there from time to time. So we went up the roof of Freeman House, and he said, the secret is that my mother and father were there. And sometimes Mum would cook like hot dogs for everyone at the first get downs. And what he was saying was they were so young and there was so much difficulty in the streets that the dances were being made to get everyone off the streets to do a positive thing. And I think that the kind of simple beauty of that and somewhat the naivety of that has got lost a bit in the journey of hip hop, because hip hop has become also so, I mean, it's not a judgment, but it's become, you know, there are different kinds of hip hop that have evolved and they've celebrated different elements of hip hop. But what happens in the prehistory is there's a lot of heart in it. Like a lot of, not naivety is the wrong word, but open-heartedness. Just a joy in it. And a desire to express without any possibility you might make money out of it. Like, think when those kids are risking their lives tagging trains, they know it's going to be washed off the next day. And why do they do it? Because, as one kid says, I think in Style Wars, the documentary says, because, Mama, when I see my name up there, I am somebody. And that's why they do it. And to me, that is the purest form of expression. That of course it's great that you're acknowledged. Of course it's great you get an income out of eventually, all of that. But the fact is that everyone in that prehistory was doing it because when they did it, they felt they were somebody. And I think that's what I've come to realize in this journey. And yeah, it's absolutely true. Why? Well, it's such a rich period, you know?
Let's take some more questions. Let's go farther back. A guy in the aisle, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, yes, sir.
Hi, I'm a movie producer, and I'm a big, gigantic fan of both of yours. You're both geniuses in your field. I made a movie called Sparkle, both versions, actually, which I produced.
Sure.
And I couldn't help noticing that girl in Get Down...
Looks so like Irene Cara.
Yes. And I was wondering whether you were influenced by that.
Absolutely. Well, Irene Cara, yes. And in fact, because all of our characters, everything in the character choices, we have a shadow, what we call a shadow, right? So some I won't go into, but Jimmy Schmidt's plays this great character called Papa Fuerte.
Right.
Who Ed Koch, who, by the way, is in the film,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And the actor playing Ed Koch is great, but Fuerte has a shadow character. Now, it means it's not actually that person, but we've taken different elements and made a kind of shadow version. And indeed, our horizon, Mylene Cruz, is kind of Irene Cara. You're right, she is the go-to person. Plus, I think Irene Cara had that kind of screen charisma, and Horizon has it too. But she was an influence, yes.
That's fantastic. This side? Oh, yeah, okay, we'll get the middle next time. Right, you got a bunch
this
of people right here.
Young lady down here.
We'll get the... excuse me.
Hi, thank you. Just a quick question on Shakespeare. Romeo and Juliet, I think, is one of the most amazing films that you have directed and brought Shakespeare to the mainstream. Are you tempted to do any more Shakespearean texts as mainstream films?
Well, the short answer is yes. Well, I'm really tempted to retire, if I be really honest with you. And in fact, I'm more than tempted. Because the Get Down, I mean, it's just not in a negative way, but the Get Down is the most absorbing, because and I will get to the Shakespeare, but... but doctor, can I tell you about my problems? the Get Down, here's the thing with the Get Down. See, there's no precedent for it, because what's going on in this streaming world and why storytellers like us are attracted to it is, first of all, you have less constraint creatively than you do in the movies, because as much as you might make a movie, at a certain point there are things, lines you can't cross because there's a giant chunk of money sitting on it. And then the creative freedom's like immense. The other thing, though, what's going on in streaming and Netflix heads this is that they don't come and say, look, would you make a pilot? Right. And then we'll decide whether we like it. They go, can you make 13 hours of this? Right? Now, they're not like, it certainly isn't television. Mm-mm. Is it cinema? It's up there. So in anyone's book, it's kind of 13 hours of that. Now, the reason I bring this up is because why it's so absorbing is apart from the research, the vast creative collaborations of all kinds of collaborators from all walks of life. In a movie, you imagine it, you research it, you plan it, you pre-plan it, you shoot it, you finish it. In The Get Down, last night we were in our space here, and I was working on four, right? It's going to go off, and we're going to start doing sound builds and music builds, and then Sunday I'll be talking about, so how's 12 going to end? Like, you know, with a white piece of paper, you know? So you're at any given moment in all parts of the process. Yeah. The reason this relates to your question, what's your name, by the way? Can you say it again?
Nima.
Nima. Beautiful. Look, if there were more than one of me, I don't know if that came out right, but anyway... there are so many things I do just for the joy of it, and one of those things most definitely would be to return to the Shakespearean canon and continue this kind of thrilling journey I went on trying to answer the question, how would Shakespeare go about making a movie? Now, I don't know if it's going to happen, but I would like to think that if I ever got a second wind and went back out there, at some point I did the primary Shakespearean pieces. And the reason for that is that I think they're such great guides in life. If you look at the journey in life, you know, Romeo and Juliet is impossible champagne, youthful love. You know, you go to Henry IV, part one, that's about transformation. You go to, you know, Hamlet, that's about being 30. 33 and fat of breath, fat and short of breath, like, you know, the dilemma, existentialism. You get up to absolute, be careful, absolute power corrupts absolutely, Macbeth, you know. And I'm more in your Lear department at the moment, you know. my children, hey, how is Goneril and Reagan? You know, we sent them off to LA today. Yeah, I've got two children, Goneril and Reagan. They're trying to carve up the empire, you know. You are nourished. I mean, I don't say it lightly. When you work on a Shakespearean text, your life is nourished. And you really get, it really makes you, it helps you. So I hope so. I really do.
Okay, people in the middle, if you want to wiggle. Let's go in, let someone in the middle, this lady's in the middle. Usually she wouldn't, someone send her a mic. Oh, well, there's two ladies in the middle. We only have time for one question, unfortunately.
Sorry, I apologize for stealing the thunder. Yeah, you talked a lot about the music, and the reason I love your work so much is that, you know, collaborative element, but there's so many other pieces to it, whether it's, you know, the costumes, the production design, and I kind of, you know, you work with these geniuses and they're creating these things to really serve a larger purpose in the framework of the narrative and kind of how that works with, you know, just speaking to those other elements a little bit in the creative process and how you kind of interweave the other aesthetic elements of.
Do you want to bring CM up?
Ladies
CM,
and gentlemen,
do you want to speak?
Catherine Martin. Yeah. Come on up, CM. Come up here, lovey. Why don't you sit in the
chair? Four-time Oscar winner.
Why don't you sit in? I'll stand by.
So you want to answer that question?
Well, Baz is very much a visual director. I think of him as a conductor, as an auteur, and we're all elements in the orchestra. So whether you're the composer, or whether you're involved in the costumes, or the props, oh God, props, the worst. They never work. actors, the pen, even if you have 700 of them, it never works when they want to go and sign the check in the close-up or on the insert. They're my... we do have a fantastic props master on the Get Down, Duke, who seems to be magical with props. So I'm very
He's a fanatic.
Blessed. He's a fanatic. Yeah. I think the great pleasure of working with Baz is that it is a true creative collaboration. He's very much in the driver's seat. He knows how he wants the characters to appear. He understands the environments that he wants them to be in. He works very much from the inside out. So he wants to be able to stage and write the staging into the script before any set is built. So it's about creating an environment that has an invisible map for the actors so that they find their performance. You know, it is organically able to be found. So I think that the pleasure and why, you know, we've worked together now for nearly 29 years. And
29
I think the reason that we still try to kill each other in the bathroom on a regular basis, but that we also equally enjoy working with each other is because, for me as a creative person, I feel I have a genuine voice in the process. And that means that Baz has the ability to be a great conductor, a great leader, so we're all travelling in the same direction, but to actually engage you creatively and to make you feel like your contribution is meaningful. And it doesn't matter if you're, you know, basically throwing the leaves in front of the camera to, you know, create an autumnal moment, or...
You can throw those leaves in a better way. Give it more.
You know, or
Let
you're the
flutter.
Star of the show. He's very difficult to compete with, as you can see.
You brought up the leaves.
Yeah, so Baz does like leaves. He likes pieces of paper in the wind. That's another favourite.
I know what you're going to say next, and I don't think you should put it out there because...
And he likes cakes. We've noticed
true.
In this...
Oh, there's a cake. There's a big cake scene in our...
There's cakes. There's a cake in every scene.
There's a cake in every episode. We've now realised that cakes are a leitmotif, and there is a cake in every single one of our shows.
No, that's not right. I just say, and look, we need some object that's going to blah, 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 that's symbolic, blah, 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 you know, and I there's like, you know, I don't mean this, but something like a cake. And people don't hear the I don't mean this bit, you know, so a cake turns up.
Yeah, so look out for the cakes in the Get Down.
There are cakes.
There are a lot of them.
What about the scene where Jimmy goes,
yeah,
nice cake.
Nice cake. And we all laugh because we watch the episodes over and over again while the fine edit is being done. And now we have a cake spotting. The first person to see the cake gets a prize. A slice of cake.
I don't even like cake, to be honest with you.
No, he doesn't.
I hate it.
How much more time do we have?
Thank you. Do come back.
So how much time do we have? Does we have to wrap it up? Okay. Hey, everyone. It's Saturday night. Baz Luhrmann.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Nelson George.